Righto, welcome back to the Maximum Cricket Podcast. My name is Matt Hunter. We have Lugsy and Jacko with me again, and this is episode number 13. Guys, a quick question. If you made 13 in a club game, or any game for that matter, could you round up to 20, you think, or is that a bit of a stretch?
Yeah, I think 13 starts to be that cutoff point. 14, you're definitely rounding up to 20-odd. 13, you've probably just got to front up.
Yeah, I'm a batsman, so 13's definitely 20. especially if you've got, you know, if I don't know if you guys, were you guys counters? Like I sort of, for at least, you know, up until about 20, I sort of always knew what I was on.
Very easy to count to zero.
Oh, yeah.
I'd count to, yeah, I'd be counting as close to 20 as possible, and then I sort of lose it a bit. Some people like can count their whole innings. I've had Jacko, you were to play with Robbo when he might have got like 100 or 90 or something like that, and he claimed the scorer's got it wrong.
That's magic.
Which is quite something.
Yeah, I think I do remember that. Raised his bat and we all thought he was on 98.
Wow. So that's what I'm saying, is if you're not a counter, you can sort of do that one where you're like, they're like, oh, how'd you go today? And you're like, oh, I didn't look, but I must have got sort of, I don't know, 15, 20. But that's, you know, that's where that 13 can easily become a 20.
Oh, yeah. And I think as as the night progresses, you have a few beers and whatnot, you know, that 13 becomes sort of 30. You sort of slew your words a little bit. And then, you just hope that no one actually checks the score.
Yeah, especially if you've got a couple away. Like, if you had a couple of boundaries in that 13, then you probably deserve 20.
Yeah. Slow outfield sort of thing.
Yeah, a couple of good shots, and that's all anyone's actually going to remember as well in the aftermatch. So, yeah, as you said, you drag that 13 to 20 by just playing three good shots.
And you got that classic, not sure how many I got, but I got a couple away and I felt good. So I'm feeling quite good out there at the moment.
Yeah, felt great, actually.
Yeah, the boys are here. Team, sit back and relax. Actually, I'm not sure anyone actually does sit back and listen to a pod these days. Normally, it's one of those on-the-go type things. So grab your favourite snack and enjoy a massive show.
Yes, Bank Maximum, the first of this contest. Oh, that is brilliant. It's a Hero Maximum. On the ground, another Hero Maximum.
Boys, snack of the week. I did send a picture on my story. I've mowed down my Memphis Meltdown pretty quickly. A wee gooey caramel. It was almost too cold though. One of those things where I probably just got it straight out of the freezer, and it was a little cold on the teeth. Probably could have waited a little longer.
Yeah, I mean, it's not exactly, you know, we're about 0 degrees here in Dunedin. It doesn't exactly scream ice cream weather, but fair play to you.
Yeah, the gooey caramel does actually need to warm up slightly from frozen, I've always found.
Yeah, 100%, 100%. So I've just got, it was a kg bag of gummy lollies. It's probably about, I'd say 3/4 full. Sort of dipped into that a little bit last night. But good to go. Have my coffee and ready to go. What are you boys got tonight?
As I said, a little bit of a left field one, but I've actually gone with the bowl of baking, like licking the bowl after the baking's gone into the tray.
Tell you what, that's
really get the boys going.
If there were like TAB odds as to what you'd be snacking, that would be quite high odds, that's for sure.
It's an outsider.
I've gone fairly rogue myself, and it's a pretty disgraceful choice that I'm not 100% ready to admit to, but 8:40 at night on a Tuesday, and I've gone to my second lift plus for the night.
I'll keep you going.
And I've also, I've got Andrew's mum quite often does a bit of baking for the flats. I've got a bit of baking here to tuck into a post pod, so we're good to go in the snack end.
What's she made, just out of curiosity?
I've actually got a wee Belgium square here, which would not normally be a go-to, but every time she bakes it, it's absolutely terrific. So, can recommend.
Made with love, you see.
Made with love, absolutely.
And speaking of love, our Caps just finished off a very enjoyable tour for our boys, 11-0 between the nations of Ireland, Scotland, Netherlands. So we're pretty happy with that. So if I just do a quick rundown of the Netherlands game, we've talked about the other two series in the past. First T20, New Zealand scraped together 148. Guptill made 45. Neesham, we 32 off 17. We exclamation mark at the end of the innings. With the ball, we've talked in the past about the reserve seamers standing up, and we definitely got that with Tickner taking 4 for 27 and Ben Sears taking 3 for 22. Both big, tall, fast bowlers, which you love to see. Netherlands all out for 132. Second T20 was far more comprehensive from the Cats' perspective, chasing down 147 and only 14 overs. Daryl Mitchell capping off one of the more crazier winter tours with 51 off 27. And Captain Mitch Santner, of all people, promoting himself to number three, smashing 77 off 42 in one of the more impressive displays from the left-hander. Boys, before we dive into these games, Santner batting at three, is that the biggest display of flexing you've seen from a skipper? Because it's pretty clear that Santner just got a bit tired of padding up, giving out throwdowns, and just decided he wanted to have a wee bat. Thoughts?
Yeah, it's a big one. Huge abuse of power, that one. Haven't actually seen it something like that in the international game ever. So kudos to Mitchell Santner.
Yeah, it's a sort of move that's more reserved for your club cricket. You sort of, yeah, probably even more your second, third grade sort of stuff. Sort of captain licks his lips playing one of the lesser sides, maybe, you know, King seconds, OB seconds sort of a setup, and decides he'll go march up the order. I do wonder who sort of, if Harry raised it, if he said to Gary Steele, like, what are the chances of me going up, or if he's just sort of gone rogue, padded up and strolled out there. Pretty interesting sort of very interesting. Obviously it's worked. It's worked wonders though.
Yeah, I mean, like, jokes aside, I did, when I watched the replay, it did look like it was a case of Netherlands had multiple left arm spinners. Yeah. And he thought he'd just come in and tee off because, you know, the ball spinning in sort of thing. And it worked, and it paid off. And he's probably, like, it's one of those cliches that we love, but he's probably better than he's shown at international level because he does do quite well at the domestic scene. But speaking of, like, captains sort of flexing their muscles, I've probably got an example of the opposite. I think we've talked about it in the past, but our old captain Robbo making another appearance, he actually did the opposite where he dropped himself down the order just so he didn't have to face Lockie Ferguson, which did not pay off. He got cleaned up pretty quickly. And I think the other thing is, and I'll stitch myself up, I was captain and I once bowled 11 overs in a one day game. So that's,
I mean, that's very, really insane.
That's a real flex if I am.
That is arrogant.
It's up there. So have you boys got anything like that?
Yeah, I did touch on the captain, if they're a bowler, will always sort of either over or under bowl themselves. They'll never have that sweet spot. So something you've just alluded to. But I mean, the biggest one for me that comes to mind is the captain that just puts himself at first slip.
Oh yeah.
They've got to get in it. Got to get in at first dog. Best place to see the game. Best place to make decisions from. No history as a gripper. Guaranteed to drop one stone cold, but they're in there.
Oh, so guilty of that.
Yeah, that's almost, the thing about that one is it's almost accepted. Like, that's a captain's right to put himself there. The other one, I definitely, yeah, a couple of captains in the past, Bradley Frost springs to mind. Just real big one for never bowling into the wind. certainly keeping himself going, sort of that, quite a few overs, the old workhorse. New ball, always a big one. He'll take the new ball at the right end. So there's a few the bowlers are pretty guilty of, I reckon. You'll see it. I see it more at trainings as well. You know, the old, like, hooks and cuts game and the captain's the one always hitting the ball. Things like that, that they really get away with.
Yeah, I mean, if you're at a Prem cricket training and you're doing hooks and cuts as your fielding drill, that's probably probably your first part you've gone wrong.
Yeah. Didn't win many games that season, I'd imagine.
Didn't win many games for many seasons, actually.
Yeah, this is a very targeted one at myself, but I was once told by a captain, as long as he had something to do with the club we were playing at the time, I would never, ever bat above 11 in any grade.
Yeah. That, to be honest, that sounds like Robbo 3 for 3.
Yeah, Geordie Scott. Geordie Scott's first appearance on the pod.
That's what you want to hear, is like an aspiring, like you're trying, you're working hard at your betting, you're hoping to move up the order, and then you hear basically under no circumstances will you ever bet up. Imagine dropping down to third grade and going, nah. You're betting behind like guys that have never played the group.
Yeah, it was in any grade, which is a real kick in the teeth.
It's a real exclamation mark, isn't it?
You know what actually is another big one for the bowlers is as soon as a team sort of 7 or 8 down, the old captain brings himself back to clean up the old tail.
Oh, there's a certain bowler from Green Island that was really good for that one. You know, we'll leave that name up to imagination. So just on the two games itself, fellas, can the Caps take anything out of these two games, do you think?
Oh, I mean, all you can take is, yeah, we should do the business against the Minnows at the World Cup, probably is the biggest takeaway from that.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing to take out is just keeping the winning rolling. Good feeling in the camp, you know? You don't want to suddenly... It's almost like winning's important for these games, but not losing them's more important. You know, not losing any momentum and just a good feeling in the changing rooms. You start losing a couple of these games and then you really start asking questions. So I think just keeping the winning going. A couple of good performances, obviously. Individuals can probably take more out of it than the team. Sort of playing for your personal sort of goals at that point.
Yeah, it did feel like, I think you touched on it there, Simon, like winning is a habit. So we've done that so far, and it's been pretty emphatic most of it. I think Ireland definitely pushed the boys the most, but the Caps definitely ticked most, like I would say 90% of the boxes they would have been looking for. So you can't really ask for much more than that. And with a big series ahead against the West Indies, with a few big dogs coming back, it's going to be a real test for the fellas. So if we do push forward to the West Indies series, which I'm very much looking forward to. I don't really fizz up for a lot of white ball cricket, but there's something about this series. Maybe it's just because we've got a full strength team together. We're not far away from the T20 World Cup. Like, the West Indies are exciting. The games are on at a bit of time. What are you guys looking forward to this one?
Yeah, massively. I think, as you've just laid out, this is probably the measuring stick leading into that T20 World Cup. Being nice, you know, have a bit of cricket on, see us dust up these minnows, but going to be very good to see us go against a perennial T20 contender and just, see where our best 11 actually sits sort of 2 months out and sort of really build some fizz for this World Cup if we win this series.
Yeah, I think that's the big one, is probably finding out who our best 11 is now. It's probably, I guess it's always more open in the T20 game. The side's always a bit more open because one big performance and you're suddenly in the mixer. But that's what I want to see. Who's our best 11 going forward now? Realistically, I think we should be too good for the West Indies. This is another series we should win. But as you say, like, they can always pull something out the old Windies. So you just got to, you got to perform well.
Yeah, it's a good point. We sort of touched on that there, Simon. Like, and I was sort of had it on my notes here. What do we think is like an acceptable result for the Blackcaps? Because I think personally, if we are going to be like a serious contender at this World Cup coming up, like up there with the Indias, Australia, England has sort of gone off, but even South Africa are looking pretty good. We probably we should win the series with a full strength side, because you think. You know, the West Indies are nice, but if we look at their form, they lost 3 ODIs to India. They lost the 5 T20 series 4-1 to India. And like, what do we if we read into those results? Does that tell us that the West Indies aren't great, or is that more just India are just really really good? Because, like, in my opinion, I think India should be favourites. Them in Australia for the T20 World Cup, you know, next March when you got the 50-over World Cup in India, India could do the double. They could unify those belts as England have tried to do.
Talking sort of like Roman Reigns there.
Yeah, Roman Reigns, you know, just imagine Kohli aloft with two belts, T20 on one side, 50-over at the other side.
Uso brothers beside him.
Yeah, he's got all the boys. He's got all the boys lifting him up like Satch in back of the day.
Yeah.
So what do you, did you, I don't know if you guys caught much of that series, but does that series say more about the West Indies or India?
Yeah, I mean, it's probably the classic cliche that it probably sits somewhere in the middle. But I mean, India are, yeah, cream of the crop when it comes to T20 cricket. I think we're starting to see the fruits of their guys just play it so much and they play it so well. But yeah, the West Indies, they're still a force. They can still get a lot going because their guys play a lot of franchise cricket. But yeah, I think New Zealand will want to win this 2-1 at a minimum, hopefully 3-0.
Yeah, I think from the highlights I caught, it's just West Indies are like, they've got a lot of players that can still strike the ball well, and they just, like, they're very inconsistent still, though. It's probably been the rap on them for years now. It's like, they've got guys that look extremely talented and get, like, 20s and then just find silly ways to get out. Their bowling probably wasn't the strongest against India, but the Indian batting lineup's pretty strong and devastating, so... But yeah, that's I guess the challenge with T20s and why you still fear a team like the West Indies is because it only takes a couple of those really talented guys to get an 80 and suddenly you lose, and then when you're heading into the World Cups, you lose a couple of games, you're out. So they're still a team to watch, and I guess a team, especially in tournament cricket, that you always take seriously.
I think the biggest thing this series could do, like, we can't lose it in terms of it could derail our plans a wee bit. Like, we've taken our best side over there. If we put them out in the park three times and we lose 3-0, that's actually going to be really panic station. So sort of what Crom touched on this Minnows tour is it's just getting that ball rolling, getting our best side winning. If it's 2-1 or 3-0, that doesn't really matter. But winning a series with our best side is going to be key here.
Yeah, I do think New Zealand is capable of winning 3-0. But in the T20s, I'll focus on the T20s because we've got the T20 World Cup going on. The ODIs will sort of take care of themselves. But I think they're capable of winning 3-0, but I'd be happy with 2-1 because the thing about the West Indies is they've got so much power. Like, it's a cliche, but they just have – their mishits go further than a lot of people's mishits, like New Zealand's mishits. They just hit the ball so hard. And they've got IPL players, Jason Holder, Hetmyer, the captain Puran. They're missing. It's a shame they don't have, like, they're sort of, it's a bit of a, I guess, a turning of a new page, I guess, when you got no Gale, you got no Bravo, you got no Pollard, and I'm not sure what Andre Russell's up to, but, you know, that's a bit of a shame. But bowling-wise, they've got Omid McCoy, he plays IPL, so they've got some franchise experience. But like, speaking of McCoy, I noticed that in the space of two T20s, he took the best figures ever for the West Indies in a T20, 6 for 17 with a W, and then it was either the next one or the one after that, he bowled 4 overs for 66 runs, which is the most expensive spell by a West Indies bowler. Now, talk about coming down to earth. Have you guys ever heard of it? Like, have you got a story about someone else being humble like that before?
Yeah, I think the only thing he can recover from that just quickly would be to say he took 6 for 70 odd off his 8 overs in the series. Just leave it at that. Don't actually split them into two.
I think just quietly that sort of sums up the West Indies, as I was saying, that they've got all the talent in the world, and sometimes, and then it just very inconsistent.
100%, 100%, and like, we touched on it before, but our number one T20 team, it's coming up. So we've got Kane, we've got Conway, we've got Southee, we've got Bolt coming back. Those are probably the four that will definitely push selections. So the way I see it is Kane and Conway have to play, but who's going to miss out? So I'll give you my 11. And then you guys tell me if you'd make any sort of changes. So if you go Guptill, Conway, Williamson, Phillips or Mitchell, you could flip that either way. 6, you've got Neesham, Bracewell at 7, Santner at 8, Sodhi, Ferguson and Bolt. So the one change you could potentially make is that leaves out Southee. which is an interesting one. So it's whether you want the extra bowler or you want the extra power in Bracewell. And then you sort of patch together that fifth bowler. Where do you guys sit with that?
Yeah, very, very similar. I don't think there's much changes to be made. I think a lot of people are going to sort of call for the Finn Allen hype train to leave the station and open the batting and win us this World Cup. But I think that's probably realistically a year or two away. Love to get proven wrong. But yeah, I think that top three is going to stay the same. And as you said, Southie, unlucky not to make that side, but maybe they squeeze him in. But yeah, that's about the best you can do, I reckon.
Yeah, I'm sort of torn a bit from, as you say, going through that. A part of you always wants to go with that, the new sort of formula of just having a, you know, a top seven that can all...
New is better. New is always better.
Yeah, and a top seven that can all whack it and all win your games, and you just go all fours. Which is sort of the way we're playing. But I think what you touched on a couple of pods ago, Munter, is realising we actually have, you know, we have done well in the past with our way of playing, with picking guys like Kane that can still win your games without having, you know, all the power in the world just through good cricket shots and sort of just knowing the game of cricket and knowing where, you know, what to do and put themselves in situations to win. So I guess that's the... At the moment, we've still got to go with what's brought us to the dance and sort of had us success in the past. How many games in the World Cup is there? Because I think there's probably a chance they'll play, you know, a couple of teams or a sort of a couple of selections will change a bit.
Yeah, I think I was looking at it the other day. Like, we're actually in a pretty tough pool. So we've got Australia and England in our pool. And then it's Afghanistan. And then it might be a couple of... qualifiers.
Yeah.
So like there's definitely room for a couple of changes, but we can't really muck around. Like we
Does it go to a top eight formula or is it a top two only?
I couldn't tell you. I'm gonna assume it's top four like it was at the last one. But if that's the case, we really can't muck around. We have to sort of hit the ground running from there. So yeah, I think Jacko hit it, like he's right. Like the Finn Allen, there's a potential he could do it, but until it's more than a potential, it's hard to just put him ahead of Gupta. And
you can't just say I'm picking Finn Allen. You've also got to say who am I leaving out.
Yeah, and I think you're probably, if Finn Allen's coming in, he's red hot form and Gupta's struggling, and you might think about it. But this Blackcaps team doesn't tend to just discard sort of experienced players like that. So like I would like, just on Gupta, I would love to see him just tee off though. I want to see him, like he's a good player, but I don't think he's the kind of player that a team bats around.
No, 100%.
I want to see him go hammer and tong like it's 2015. And if he gets out, he gets out.
Yeah, and I think having that Conway Williamson at 2 and 3 would actually really give him that license to do it. Because Conway and Kane are probably good enough to go at 10s in the power play with the field up without that risk element, which lets Gupta just, I mean, absolutely let loose and hopefully, as you said, yeah, score some big runs for us.
Yeah, it's an interesting one because, I mean, the man of the hour at the moment, Brendan McCullum, but I think that's almost when Guppy looked at his best as well. And I don't know if that was just a confidence thing of opening with Brendan, but when they were both just going for it, that's when I think Guppy was actually looking at his best. So if Kane, and I'm sure, you know, he's a good enough cricketer to realise all of this, I'm sure if he just says, you know, you've got a bit of a licence here, just bat normally, bat, you know, bat aggressively, hopefully we'll see the best of Guppy.
If we move on to more cricket in the Northern Hemisphere, probably the biggest cricket going on at the moment is the Women's Commonwealth Games, I would say. And it was actually quite an enjoyable tournament. Australia evidently were too good for all the teams, which was pretty expected, but they were pushed, to be fair. They were too good for India in the final, although India did give them all they could handle. These two teams were definitely the best two teams here, no doubt about that. Australia batted first, made 161 off their 20. India were about 120 off of two, needing 40 odd off six overs. The Aussies dug deep to take 8 for 34 to complete the trilogy of T20 World Champions, 50 over World Champions, and now Commonwealth Games gold medalists. That is unifying the belts for sure. The bronze, but our ferns, our white ferns, bounced back from an absolute hiding from the English girls in the group stage, where we got bowled out for 71, which is rough, actually. England batted first. They only got 110 on the back of an outstanding bowling performance from our ferns. Six different bowlers took poles as they showed a bit of depth with the bowling, which is nice to see. Something that doesn't have the same depth is their batting, which if you look back at this tournament, when the girls have done well, the top three is fired. When they haven't, they've struggled. Yeah, it didn't matter as they smoked 110 and 12 overs, which is nice. Susie Bates, we quick fired 20 off 10. Meili Kerr with 20-odd, and Captain Sophie Devine with a second straight 50 to take home bronze. Boys, from the home World Cup, which is a bit of a disappointment for our ferns, we've got to be pretty stoked with a bronze, surely.
Yeah, the girls will be really happy with that, I think. I mean, there's nothing better than going on tour as a sports team, so they've ticked that box. I mean, they've given themselves something to sort of strive for, which is pretty cool, which is a sort of a Commonwealth medal. They've actually gone and got one. So, I mean, they've gone on tour, they've won, happy days.
Yeah, it was a good result. And I think they were actually, a few things went differently in that semi. They actually pushed Australia a bit there as well. It was probably their fielding that really let them down there, unfortunately. But yeah, I watched most of that that bronze medal match, and yeah, really good performance with the ball. Bit of risky captaincy as well, as they, and they sort of were mixing up the bowlers quite well, and I think they brought on a girl that had only bowled a couple of overs the whole tournament. It all sort of worked out for them. I have to say that Amelia Kerr, she could be one of our great cricketers, I reckon. Like, huge expectation to put on someone. But she's like, 21 years old, already played 100 games for New Zealand over the format.
That's wild.
Amazing, like, an amazing time for a young cricketer as well, with, like, the success of women's BBL and Commonwealth Games and that. Just lands the ball so well for a young bowler. And her batting's coming along a lot. So I think, yeah, huge future for her in the game. And yeah, really good result.
Well, I mean, like, I think, didn't she have a double ton at like 17 or something outrageous?
Yeah,
like,
well, just even mentally to do that at a reasonable level is pretty tough.
Oh, 100%. And like, it does seem like the women's game is hitting, like, it's skyrocketing in popularity. They've got those new deals, which is going to give basically going to add a bit more professionalism to the girls' game in New Zealand, which is nice to see. You can see that's why, like, one of the reasons why Australia are so good. Like, they are professionals all the way through. And with Meili Kerr only being, what you said, 21, 22, like, the world's at her feet.
Yeah.
You know, she's got to be a future captain.
I mean, and she's going to play, like, if she wants, professional cricket for, like, you know, 10, 15 years and be one of the first to do that. So already have the experience she has with that ahead of her, she could, yeah, be a real superstar of the women's game. Tell you what, talk about a girl that's never going to have to bowl into the wind or is going to be allowed to bring herself on when they're 8 or 9 down. She's going to be able to do whatever she wants for a long time.
I'll open the batting and then I'll bowl where I want, sort of jobs.
Yeah, I'll be sort of doing most things without training here, team, so until you guys catch up.
Just on that, serious question. Over-unders game played for Amelia Kerr here. She's, what, 20, 100 played? Could she get to, 400? Is that out of the question?
So how long has she played for? Like 4 years?
Let's say four years. She'd have another 15, potentially, if her body holds up.
I mean, if you think about it, how old is Susie Bates? Susie Bates must be,
she'd be into her late 30s, wouldn't she?
35-ish. Yeah. I know Sophie Devine's like 32. So if Susie, like, if Meili Kerr plays till she's 35, let's say, that's another 13 years. She's already played 5. I mean, Jesus Christ.
Record numbers. I mean, she looks after her body like LeBron. We're talking, you know, we're talking hundreds of games here.
She's dropping a milli a year on the body, you reckon?
If this game gets really professional and she's got that sort of cash to throw around.
Woman's IPL.
Yeah.
Get that woman's IPL guy.
You have to pay that, Crom, you reckon?
Oh, I wish you could. Because if you could, I would.
We have to pay on like a, what does he have? Like a cryogenic chamber.
Yeah, cryogenic. Got a float tank or whatever it is.
How much is that in quarterly payments?
Oh,
still
yeah.
Too much for me, I reckon.
Yeah, but it is divided by four, though.
Yeah, and when they send you emails, you won't be able to check them, so it'll be fine.
Yeah.
The only other cricket that's sort of going on at the moment is we've got the 100, which is quite a big deal in the UK. So I guess we'll sort of touch on it, but I'll be honest, I've watched a total of 0 minutes of this competition this year. But I did have a wee nosy last year. So I suppose we could just talk about the whole concept and I guess the whole thing as a whole. Like, I personally have struggled to get into it, but it does seem like they love it over in the UK. And it does seem to be quite good for the women's game and also just sort of casuals, which can only be good. But like, for those that don't know, each innings is 100 balls, i.e. 100. They've basically scrapped overs as a concept entirely. So a bowler can bowl a maximum of 10 balls in a row from one end. You can change the bowler after 5 balls if you choose. Now, I guess the whole point is to make the game more inclusive with less stoppages, etc. So I get it, but for me personally, I struggle to follow it just because I'm used to seeing overs, like how many you need per over, that sort of thing. What are your guys' thoughts? And do we actually need another format?
Yeah, I haven't actually watched a ball. I don't think I will watch a ball. That probably sums up my thoughts. No, but I mean, look, if you reach a few more audiences, again, if you can grow the game a little bit, it helps. But the question's got to be asked, at what point are you not growing cricket? So, I mean, yeah, it's not cricket as the traditional fans know it. But, I mean, if the ECB gets a little bit more in the coffers, keeps them happy, keeps maybe the rest of cricket world going over. So, yeah, won't be watching a ball.
Yeah, I think, I mean, beat this out if you have to, but it sounds pretty fucking gross when you explain it.
Try reading a scorecard.
Yeah, wow. But I think the big point is, what does this replace? Or is there room for a four format of cricket? It just seems way too much. I don't know. Is anyone else playing it in the world, or just an English thing? Because it just seems a bit much, really. But I wouldn't rule it out, and especially if you say if it's another thing that's growing the women's game, then by all means they can play it, everyone can play it, but it does seem a bit much.
Yeah, I've got I don't have a lot to add to that, I'm not going to lie. But yeah, it's really tough to look at a scorecard and know what the hell is going on, that's for sure. So if we move on to out or not out.
Yeah, out or not out, the 100 out.
boys are pretty out on it at this stage, but we've been known to jump ship. We always if it does take off, we're back on.
I'll tell you what, the listeners go 80% not out on the 100. We're all aboard. Get on the 100 train.
They bring a game to the uni oval, you know, bit of pursue the boys around. I'm probably going to the games, aren't I?
Oh yeah, just don't. I'm not looking at the scorecard. That's sure. So this week on Out or Not Out is, I think what I'll do is I'll say the question and then I'll sort of explain where it's from if you haven't seen it. So the question is, should you take an acid trip before a game of cricket? If you take it at face value, you're thinking Munter's lost the plot, and you'd probably be right, except for there was a documentary that came out. Early this week, from a company called The Spinoff, and they're looking at lost New Zealand sportsmen, sports people, I guess they would say, and they touch on a fella by the name of Heath Davis, who played for the Blackcaps in the late 90s, I believe. And I must admit, I see myself as a bit of a cricket nuffy, and I'd never heard of this fella. But I tell you what, it is one of the best 15 minutes you'll ever spend. It is a top doco. I've done so well. So the basis of the doco is Heath Davis has come out as the first gay cricketer, professional cricketer, ever, I believe. I'm sure there's some more out there, but to come out is a cool story. But I think there were so many interesting stories during this doco that we couldn't not talk about it. It was so basically he was like the Dennis Rodman of cricket. He was a wild, wild person. Incredibly talented, apparently could bowl up to 150 clicks, couldn't land him. Famously bowled his first ball of test cricket for four wides. Apparently bowled a whole lot of no balls all the time. And also he was quite a character because he made a joke about, he actually lost his leg later in life. And he sort of was like deadpan saying that I was sick of bowling no balls, so I cut it off. which it's one of those ones where you feel like you shouldn't laugh, but you do it. You do laugh because it's funny. So I guess the question isn't really should you take an acid trip before a game of cricket. My question is a bit further. Well, he said it wasn't advisable and he shouldn't have got caught. But what happens if he played well with an acid trip? Is it one of those things, and we all know these superstitions in cricket where they put on a certain pair of socks, and then they score 100 or take wickets, and then they always do that thing. So if he took a five or a six, does he continue taking acid trips before each game of cricket? Boys, a lot to unpack there, but thoughts on the acid trip and thoughts on just superstitions in the game.
I mean, great doco, lot to unpack. His erraticness may actually be explained by the fact he was playing cricket on acid. tough to land it when you're seeing a lot of different things going on out there that aren't actually there, or you know, get your foot behind the line when you don't know where the line is. So that could explain that part of it. But yeah, as you said, total dangerous line, because if he did play well, there is that going to be that feeling of I'm gonna have to take acid every game here. Which is a tough one. Cricketers in general, very superstitious. Very, very superstitious bunch. A lot of blokes will have the same thigh pad they've had since they were 14 because they scored runs once in it, etc. Yeah, I suppose superstitions for me, I'd be out on them because, I mean, you can't have something you're relying on and if I do this, I'm going to go well. But yeah, I mean, it flows nicely into our coach's corner, which we will get to soon. But yeah, superstitions, interesting to have, but I mean, you can't be relying on them for mine.
Yeah, I mean, there certainly was a lot to unpack with that doco. First of all, in seriousness, a very, very good doco. And it's probably inspired a few of the younger guys maybe who are battling with that, you know, potentially are gay and wanting to come out. Probably had a pretty serious tone to it. And his story, I mean, probably shows my age a bit, but I was a bit of a Heath Davis fan as a youngster. And it's funny, like one of these real erratic guys, he always had different hair and stuff, who would probably be a bit of a superstar in this day and age, I'd imagine, with social media. If everyone sort of want to just enjoy a sportsman that's a bit rogue and a bit different, I feel like he'd be actually really embraced in this day and age. Probably absolutely hated by the media, but really embraced by fans. As you say, the sort of Dennis Rodman type, the easy comparison to make is just a real out there dude, but not just like an out there dude that was sort of scraping around in club cricket, like actually represented the country and was like a really good bowler.
Well, imagine if he had the coaching and sort of training that they have nowadays.
Oh, absolutely.
He obviously had the raw talent. Like he probably plays a lot more cricket for New Zealand nowadays.
Yeah, and I swear to God, he was playing for Wellington before he made the move to Auckland, or he may have been playing for Auckland, and they used to have the old Shell ODI final on like TV 1 and 2, free to wear back in those days. And he's copped a bouncer, no helmet on, straight to the dome, and just literally just taken it. Sort of Happy Gilmore style. Like, legitimately just taken it straight to the noggin and just hasn't batted an eyelid.
So a pretty, yeah, a really rogue individual. As I said, yeah, you probably don't want to go down the road of doing well or taking a five for an acid. As a guy that's played sort of pushed the limits on being hungover and maybe, you know, over the limit occasionally, I could not play cricket drunk, so I just can't even imagine acid. But yeah, superstitions, another, as you said, very, very sensible answer from Jacko with the, you probably just can't rely on them. A lot of people get pretty deep with it and say it's pretty weak to rely on them. But there's also, you know, there's a few fun ones, sort of shoe on, you know, shoe on, and other shoe on, pads on, each glove on, like right and left. So there's a few superstitions that guys will absolutely stand by, but as Jacko said, in seriousness, you probably can't rely on them.
Yeah, I think it's a tough one because it feels like there's a difference between routines and superstitions.
Yeah, that's where you're probably drawing the line, eh?
And we'll probably get into this in Coach Corner a bit more in depth later. But I guess superstitions are like really hardcore stuff. Like we're talking like your Neil McKenzie's type things. Like I played with a guy at school who he had to walk around the boundary before he batted, and then no one else could touch his bat after that. Otherwise, he'd have to do it again. And there was one time like he was batting, and then he came off for drinks, and he put his bat down, and like I walked out of the changing room. You see a bat, what do? You know, you pick it up. You have a couple of nick off or whatever, and he's given me this massive spray, and then took the bat and started running off during the drinks and like sprinted around the boundary.
I mean, I just can't imagine playing with this guy and not doing that at least, you know, twice a game.
Oh, he was.
Was he quite a popular figure or nah?
Because I definitely got wound up.
Yeah,
He was a bit older than me, so I probably wasn't one of those people that did it.
Yeah,
A few others definitely took it to him. But like routines can be important for consistency. They just kind of make you safe.
I was thinking just on the subject of Dear Heath. Did you have any cricketers sort of you've played with that you've? Because I think most cricketers are a pretty similar breed. Like you can sort of, you know, you can sort of spot a cricketer a wee way away. But, you know, I think every club's got a couple of guys, you know, good cricketers. But you think, how the hell did they get into the game of cricket? Like this guy's just so different to all of us. But a good guy and a good cricketer. But you just wonder how they got into it.
Nothing like that. But I'd say the craziest thing I've seen a guy do is someone sort of like cleaned up guy in the opposition, and then he went over and picked up the stump and then like used it as like a fake rifle and was like pretend shooting seagulls. Good guy, you know, wears his heart on the sleeve, but definitely cut from a different sort of cloth.
Yeah, sort of Flawsy sprung to mind out on the Tyree. Bloody good bugger, but like post game sort of go grab his 24 box of Woodies or something, just a bit, you know, would grab a spades, but it was just away and I, you know, ride into his cars and tatted right up and everything. And what got this guy into cricket? But he absolutely loved it.
Because he was gas.
Yeah, like an absolute stiff of the days as well. So are we in on the acid or are we out on that?
I'm probably out on it for the sakes of the younger viewers.
Yeah.
Slippery slope if you're not out on acid.
Yeah. This podcast may not last much longer, actually, to be fair.
We kids, definitely, it's an out on the acid.
Starting today, you will play like winners, act like winners, and most importantly, you will be winners. If you listen and learn, you will win basketball games. And gentlemen, winning in here is the key to winning out there.
Yeah, so Coach Corner this week. So if you do want to reach us, send us an email, maximumcricket21@gmail.com, or send us a wee DM on Insta. Occasionally I'll send up a story asking for some questions, or if you want a guaranteed, I will definitely, because we had quite a few this week that I couldn't get to, which is always good. But if you want a definite reply from us boys, tell you what you can do is go to Apple Podcasts, give us a wee 5-star rate, and then instead of a review, ask us a question during the review. Tell you what, if you do that, you're 100% you'll be on the next pod. There's a wee plug for you. So this week we got a lovely message on Instagram. I'm going to read the whole thing and then we'll touch on it. So, hey, MC crew, Munter, Lugsy, and Jacko, if you're clocking in for this episode, what is the best way to deal with the mental side of batting strategies to switch on and off in the middle? Any help is hugely appreciated. Thanks, boys. You are all legends. Another quick side note, my club is North Shore Cricket Club. When I'm not playing school cricket, I'm 17. Any experience or memories playing for Cornwall versus North Shore Cricket Club? Just a sidebar, my only experience is playing at Cornwall Park for club nationals. I've said this on a previous pod, but I'll never forget playing at Cornwall number 3. Big Lockie Ferguson having 4 slips on the boundary, guys nicking through the slips for 6 type stuff. So all 3 of us played in Dunedin while Jacko still plays in Christchurch. So also he said, love listening to the pod and we'll be showing the Patreon some love too soon. First of all, really appreciate that. That is unbelievable. We love the support. And a wee quick plug here for our Patreon. That is patreon.com/matchroomcricket if you do want to help everyone's 13th favorite cricket podcast crack the top 10. Righto, let's talk switching on and off. A real underrated skill in terms of batting a long period of time. So the first thing I'd like to say is I feel like you've got to have a real love for batting, just the skill of batting. Like you're at home in the middle, you just don't, like you love the game, but when you're not batting, something's wrong. I'm talking like your Brian Lara's, your Steve Smith's, your Kane Williamson. Like Steve Smith shadow batting at midnight, Williamson getting tennis out elbow from batting too much. These guys are just not content with the start. Whereas myself, a clubby, if I had a 20 or 30, I'm happy. That gets me on the side next week. I'm more than happy. You said it. I mean, you said in your message, switching on and off. That's what to do. But why and how do we do that? First of all, it's a way of conserving mental energy. Batting a long time is tiring work, not just physically, but also mentally. It's not possible to stay switched on for hours on end. Myself personally, I always struggle with that. You know, boys always used to give me sort of stick for starts and that sort of stuff. And basically, it's just because I'd be too worked up. I'd start really well, I'd look good, then I'd just make a dumb brain fade because I would just I'd just run out of gas mentally, basically. There's heaps of ways to switch on and off. It's not a real one size fits all. When I was around your age, I read Mark Richardson's book. It's about the mental game. He always used to remark center after every ball, just sort of scratch the crease. It was his way of signing on and then signing off when he came back. He'd go away, he'd walk away from the stumps to try and switch off, have a look into the distance, see what's happening. Then when the time's right, switch back on. You can break it up even more to when the bowler lets the ball go. At that point, the only thing that matters in the world is that ball. Not the ball before, not the ball after, not what's happening in the weekend. So at that point, we use an incredible amount of energy just from focusing on the ball. And we don't want to overuse it. If we overuse it, brain fades. So some people like to give themselves mental cues just before the ball's released. Like me personally, I would always whisper like next ball. It would just tell me to sort of focus on this ball, nothing else. Obviously, as I said before, it didn't work, but it may for you. Boys, have you got any experience, have you got anything to add on the old switching on and off sort of jobs?
Yeah, I suppose this is sort of where we dangerously creep into the superstitions versus routine sort of argument. But probably the biggest thing you need is a in-between ball routine, or like a pre-ball routine as a batter. Like the best in the world all have them, and that's just, I guess, a way to distract your mind or something to go through, which, like, A, will keep you busy in that time so that you might not be thinking about the next ball, or your mind can just sort of get lost in something menial and then back to the task at hand. Like Steve Smith's a great example. I think it's in the test doco, and he says he's adjust his right pad, left pad, box, glove, glove, bat, tap center twice, ready to go sort of thing. So yeah, I mean, a pre-ball routine is massive. I know guys that take five steps out, five steps back, marking center every ball is one of them. Groundsmen will eventually hate you, but that's all right as long as you're scoring runs. But yeah, I think getting that routine down between balls is massive, because it takes your energy somewhere else. And then, yeah, as I said, that menial task gives your brain something to do that sort of it finds comfort in, and it finds relaxation in that repetitiveness and that comforting action. So yeah, that's probably your biggest thing in terms of switching on and off.
Yeah, it's an interesting one, because I think everyone thinks of switching on and the next ball as being the big issue, but I think switching off, properly switching off in between balls is probably just as big of an issue.
Yeah, good point.
Because if you can't switch off and you're just out there the whole time dialed in and focused, it makes it really hard. So I think that, yeah, if you'd sort of talk to yourself and realise what's my biggest issue here? Am I not switching on for balls I should be, or am I just never switching off and it's just grinding away at me and then I'm doing something silly? So I think that would be the first one to work out is sort of what you are having the biggest issue with. And then you sort of just got to know yourself, like what sort of personality type do you have? Like if you're quite a relaxed person in general, then try and just make being out there fun and sort of in between balls just embrace like the chatter of the field and everything. Like I quite enjoyed that stuff. Like when a team was really loud, I liked sort of just being out and feeding off that. And then, I mean, everyone's going to say it. You need your trigger for the, for once that bowler hits his mark and it's focus time, then I think you've got to have your trigger, whether that's, you know, a couple of taps on the ground, or in most batters, I would say, have always something they say to themselves. I was just always be positive, watch the ball, be positive, watch the ball, just as the bowler ran in. So that's sort of what worked well. I don't know if it worked for me, but that's what I found I wanted to do. I don't think many guys can be like a Steve Smith that are just so, like he's talked about like not sleeping barely for 5 days of a test. Like, I just don't think there's many guys that are going to be able to do that. And I wouldn't say to any young cricketer to try and copy that. But what you did say, Munter, about guys like him and just absolutely loving the game and loving to bat, that is a big one. You've got to actually want to be out there for sort of hours on end, prepare to be out there for hours. And then just know yourself, your own personality and how you want to bat and how you want to play the game, and then go from there.
Yeah, just touching on that switching off aspect, Crom, as you said, knowing yourself and knowing what you need. A big one you can figure out is what you want between overs. Because, I mean, I've not a batter in any sense of the word, but played in teams where, I mean, some of the batters are very intense, need to talk through every ball, every decision, every field placement between overs, and other guys need to actually just switch off, not talk about cricket, talk shit for 5 seconds in between overs, and then sort of back to the task at hand. So, yeah, figuring that out and letting the boys know.
Six balls is probably, even if you're not strike, you know, not on strike, you can probably focus pretty intently even in between those balls on cricket for six balls. And then in between overs, have a real deep breath and just switch off. Obviously, as you say, though, you might be batting with someone that's real intent and wants to talk about everything, but that is one chance to switch off. And then also, I think probably an underestimated part of this is what you're doing pre-batting as well. Because that can be another time when you're just completely dialed in, and that can be hours sometimes. So you've got to learn to sort of somewhat focus on what's happening while you're not batting, but also relaxing as much as you can in there as well.
Yeah, massive point there. And that's probably why I always liked opening the batting.
Yeah, 100%.
I couldn't wait. I needed to get out there because I couldn't relax before batting. It was just, I would be using mental energy while not even batting. So that was just how I worked. And it's just, I guess, it's knowing yourself. The biggest key here is everyone knows how to switch on. I guess it is going to be switching off. It's little things like, you know, even just if you feel yourself getting fatigued, just get off strike, get to the other end. I noticed a lot of people, some people like to take their gloves off at the non-striker's end.
Mm.
And, you know, they might think they might drop the gloves, or it might be niggly running, that sort of thing. But what it does do is, it sort of breaks up batting and not batting. So I think Conway might do it. I think, correct me if I'm wrong, I think he does do it where he takes his gloves off.
I think Davey Warner does it quite a bit too.
Yeah, and it's sort of like a sign on and off. So when he's got his gloves off, he's kind of chilled. And then when he he's sort of strapping those gloves off, it's sort of like focus time. So that's sort of the key. Find something that works for you, whether it's, you know, chatting to the umpire, just chatting in your head, picking a fight with the opposition, if that's your personality. Yeah, if it's not, don't do that.
And not actual fisticuffs either.
It's quite tough though. Like, it is tough because there's sometimes where it's real easy. Like, if you're opening the bat in, I don't know if it's the same for you, Mum, but like when you're opening the bat in, which we both did, and like the bowling's of a high level, it's quite easy to be zoned in. And then it's sort of, I guess it's why so often like part-timers take the odd wicket, because that's when it's real easy to switch off.
Oh, the amount of times I would get out to a first change bowler, it was
quite easy to be dialed up and fizzing up for the opening bowlers.
Yeah, I had a lot of conversations with coaches, and the old man used to be my coach. He used to just, you did all the hard work. It's like, I know, but I don't have an answer for you, sorry.
The hard work's a tough one, eh? You did the hard work.
Yeah, cheers. Just what you want to hear. cheers, Dad. Yeah.
Yeah, no, I think the only thing is you've always got that emergency call for fresh gloves or a drink if you feel like you're really slipping and need a wee reset. Something you can use if you really can just feel yourself gone and you feel like that shot's going to come any moment. Just call for some gloves.
And probably my last one is, I guess it's, you know, as the game gets more or has got more and more professional, like actually just be physically fitter as well. Being physically fitter makes being mentally fitter a lot easier.
Yeah, that's a good point there.
And don't eat your snacks.
Speaking of like looking after yourself, Simon, I believe you had a big weekend.
No, oh, thanks, man.
Was it a work drinks or something? Was it?
Yeah. We had a bit of a works blowout. Went out to Ark Brewery. Obviously, I'd love to say more, but I don't have much memory of it to give you. Found myself woken up in the flat, which is always a bonus, sort of most clothes off, covered in peanut butter.
Keys, wallet, phone there though?
Yeah, keys, wallet, phone, and passport, a big one for me.
The big four ticks.
Yeah, that was there. A pretty sheepish walk into work on Nungie after potentially, you know, dropping the old love word on a few people. It's just, it's just one of those nights, isn't it?
Yeah. Did you get into any of that peanut butter in the morning? Or?
No,
I don't think there was much left. It was sort of just all over me, really. I'll tell you what, I've dropped 15 at the night and day, and I'm yet to work out how that's happened, because I've got no semblance of what I could have possibly had. But I've got a couple of scrapes on the elbows, which potentially maybe I took a tumble and lost the food. I'm just
about three or four tubs of peanut butter by the sounds of it.
Yeah, well, that's it.
Yeah, tub peanut butter, loaf of bread.
Yeah, well, on one last blowout this set down, then I'll probably call it for a couple of weeks, I reckon.
Yeah, then we're close to cricket season rolling back around, and those Saturday nights start creeping up on you again.
Oh, yeah.
Getting into our 30s now, Simon. Breaking down?
Yeah. I'm just not listening, though. It is happening, but I'm not listening. I'm more of a Jimmy Anderson. I'm going on 40.
That's probably us for another week there, team. Thank you to Lugsy and Jacko for joining us for another week. Sensational as always. And, of course, thank you to our Academy Award-winning listeners for continuing to listen to this. I don't even know what you call it at this stage, but, yeah, just continuing to listen to us. Really appreciate it. While you are still listening, if you're here, chuck us a like, a subscribe, rate a review. Helps the cause. But in the meantime, Lugsy, Jacko, have yourself a great week, and we will catch you next week.
Thanks, mate.
Cheers, mate. Have a good one, eh?